to record this actually. But right, it hurts. It doesn't feel that good. You're falling down all the time when you're first learning to snowboard. And then, you know, the first couple of, I don't know, times you go, it's like, I don't know why I'm doing this. But then every now and then you get one of those little moments where it's nice. And you're like, that's fun. And then pretty soon those moments start getting strung together. And then, you know, not too long, you know what you're doing. So it's like that with anything. Snowboarding, skiing. Swimming, skiing, tennis, basketball, right? When you first go out on the court, you're just all left feet and thumbs, right? But then after you do it for a while, you get good at it. So somebody's just expressing to me that they felt, in my words, they didn't say use this phrase, but they felt a little bit like they were in the deep end. How many people feel like you've been thrown into the deep end? I still feel like that, and this is my fourth time teaching this class. Right? So this material is a little bit challenging, and you guys have been given a lot. You have been thrown into the deep end, but you know you're going to learn through just trying to make your way through it and pick up what you can pick up. So I don't want to go so fast that everybody gets left behind, but I don't want to go too slow, you know. I want to have a nice pace and then also kind of get into, stay on point with what this is about, which is trying to do websites and do them dynamically. How many people, the pace in here has been too fast? Like, whoa, it's too much. How many people, it's okay? How many people, it's too slow? People have been in here before already. They're like, yeah, we got this stuff. Let's keep going. All right, so we have some good news. To say it again. How do you say it?
Jib Jot
is our another teaching assistant in the class. So we have this Jib Jot.
Yeah.
Jib Jot.
Yeah.
Still trying to get the pronunciation. You could call him JJ. He said, you call me JJ. I want to try to figure out how to say it the right way. I might be slipping back to JJ. And then we have some other experienced people in here. Daniel is also a TA. Eunice is in here to help give assistance. And these are people who just come to the class because they like Go programming. Of course, you guys too. But I know I want to offer you up because then people, you know, if you want to help, awesome. But, you know, it's no burden. But these three people in the front are signed up to help us out. So we got lots of assistance. We'll give you a little bit of a preview of what we'll be seeing today. So at the end of today, this will be your homework assignment to build that. All right. And the lecture videos are all there on YouTube to show you how to build it. How many people look at that? No problem. I could build that. How many people look at that and I don't have a clue where I'd start? Cool. But that's kind of exciting. Like, you know, by next week at this time, you'll have this skill to be able to build something like that. And so I can't teach you everything about this field in the time we have together, but I can give you the resources to learn it. And I could teach you through video. So the videos to learn how to do this are just YouTube Todd McLeod. And then when you get to YouTube Todd McLeod, you go to playlists, and then learn HTML and CSS, right? And if you are watching this video online somewhere out there in the world, you're not in my class here at Fresno State, I'm saying this for the people who are watching the video on YouTube right now, or at some point in the future, and you come to YouTube and you can't find this playlist, I'm going to be deleting this playlist sometime around May of 2016, and you will then be able to go over to Udemy, and all those videos will be on Udemy, and so Udemy Todd McLeod, and you'll be able to find that as one of my classes on Udemy. So if you're watching this video online, you'll be able to find that as one of my classes on Udemy. And you'll be able to get into the class for only $9 with the code Let's Go. Okay? So just heads up if you're watching the video online. But for you all in the class right now, or for people before May 2016, come in here and click on this playlist. And these first videos here, review, CSS, and then border radius, and then solution. Right? They take you up through how to do it. 37 videos. So maybe you don't need to know, watch them all. If you know what you're doing, you could just build it. Maybe you just look at the code and figure it out because you could find the code on GitHub. goes to 11. And that code is repos, HTML, CSS. That code is all right here. These don't correspond number to number with the videos. So here's the solution right there, 22, right? And so here's the HTML, right? And then the CSS. And so you might just like say, jump into the code and can I figure this code out? However you learn best. And if you want more explanation, you could hang out with me in video land and watch me on video, because you didn't get enough of me in the classroom. You just want more. So not only are we going to build that, the HTML and CSS, that's your assignment for over the weekend, but we're also going to learn how to use Go and to serve that file, right? And so we'll do this, and we'll walk through this code here in a second. But here's the code. And so inside the code, we have listen and serve. Cool. And it serves on port 8080. And we're not passing in any data. And sorry, that's the serve mux. Listen and serve. Address and handler. So that's the handler. And so when we run this, we lost. Is it back?
The screen just got a lot darker.
Goes to 11, and we're in Golang web, and that is 17.
Oh, it makes the entire screen dark when the console's up. Okay.
I didn't change into that. All right, so that's running. And I come over here, localhost 8080. Nothing. I gotta look at my routes. And then 17, my route should be foo. Do I have a foo? Localhost 8080. There we go. It's just taking a second to start up. And I could do foo, or I could do Toby. And it serves up some images.
And if one of us typed in the IP address of his computer, you'd get that too.
All right, so we'll step through and look at how to do all that. Anybody have any questions before we get started? That's just a preview.
Do you want us to view exactly that, or can we just run
it? Yeah, you could change it. Just an idea.
Oh, this is unrelated, but can you show us the link to the syllabus again?
Uh-huh. Syllabus.
We had a short link, didn't we?
Yeah. And to find it, I have to bring this up. It's right on the... It's fudgy dye. FDGYDY. All right. Somebody also asked about WebStorm. So if you do WebStorm student, and you could get free for students, and then just go in here and fill out their information, and they should send you a license. If that doesn't work, let me know.
Yeah, what they'll do is you'll create an account with them, and then you can log in with their with the WebStorm with your account, and it will let you have everything.
I already installed it in the trial version. So what I have to uninstall it or?
I think the trial edition is the complete edition.
Yeah.
So you might have to go into the menus a bit, but there should be a login with JetBrains account button somewhere. That once you got the JetBrains account set up, it should in with it, with your credentials and have full access.
Anybody have any other questions?
What if it's taking us too long to get through the Go lectures?
Mm-hmm.
There are a lot of
them. Just,
yeah, it's 22 hours of material, 22 hours of lecture. That's not even like taking time to figure it out yourself and run it. That's a really great question. And if transitioning to the language, like figuring out how to do the language, we could slow down and we could spend time on that. So I think it will be a little bit of a painful process for a couple of weeks. Like in the past, we took a lot of time first couple of weeks and we just learned the language. But all that stuff's out there for you. So I want to, you know, this semester goes really fast as it is. So I want to get to a place where we're actually doing web things. And to do that, trying a different approach. You got all that content out there to go learn the language. And if you're watching this online, the place you go to get that is, again, Udemy Taught in the Cloud. And you can see all my courses. And then here's the Go course for learning the language. And the code to get you into that for $9 is Let's Go. Let's go. Just let's go. So do what you can on your own, learning the language. And then we'll also be looking at how to do web programming with Go and talking about the language, like, oh, this is that. And so as you have questions about the language, you know, we could stop and answer them and bring your questions in. And if it's if you guys are struggling too much, we'll just slow it down. Cool. Mm-hmm. You want to do it next week? like the layout so far, and I've just been trying to figure out the, because there's no textbook for web programming Go. There's a few things out there, but there's none that I wanted to adopt for the class. And so we're creating our own material as we go and figuring out our own pathway. And fortunately, I had the opportunity over the summer to spend $100,000 and hire all the people I wanted to learn from. It was crazy, dude. It's like there's this grant, and like my colleague didn't know what to do with the grant, and it's for workforce development and for training teachers and, you know, creating job opportunities. And I said, let's do an awesome summer web boot camp. And so for 10 weeks, 5 days a week, 8 hours a day, right, we spent $100,000 and we flew in all the people I wanted to learn from. I hand chose them. And so one of the dudes we flew in was Caleb Doxey. And Caleb Doxey created golangbook.com. And then he also has this new book, which is one of the books that I recommend. It's great. I've ordered it. I haven't got it yet. It's just released like beginning of this month. It's like first time, huh?
Are you doing the summer thing?
I wish. Yeah, no, the money, they're doing something else with it this year. I suggested it, but they're like, we're going to do something else. Okay. But he came for 4 weeks and taught us and created this code base. And so he gave us a really good pathway. And you could go watch Caleb.
It's actually from his Golang book. It's got links to him, too, with descriptions, I think, of each session.
Oh, did he put those in there?
Yeah,
right here at boot camp?
Yeah.
So he's changed this a little bit. And then where does that go? And then, and he's put some of the videos in there. So you can find them right there. And you could also find them. I put them all into one big list. See that video on YouTube? How to Surf Like a Pro in 25 Minutes. Awesome. That could be Kelly Slater in 25 minutes. This is me deep in the barrel and triple overhead pipeline. So 142 videos, learn to code Golang training. So the first week was the language. And then the next 3 weeks were web programming. And so the code base he created, we based our curriculum off of that. So we had somebody who is one of the leaders in the field show us the correct way to do this and then also create the code pathway for us. And so he went, it's very thorough stepping stones. I wanted to give you guys a little bit of a quicker start. So last night, until like 11, I was like, you know, should I be showing you TCP and figuring out all the fundamentals of TCP and thinking about showing you that? But then I was like, I think I'm just going to jump straight into let's serve some pages and bring up the router, and then we could step back and look at TCP so you guys could see some results kind of quick, build a page, be able to serve it. And I was thinking next week would be kind of cool to even do DigitalOcean, so now we're you know able to put that up onto a box and a remote Linux server and serve our pages remotely, you know? And then after that, maybe step straight into App Engine. And then after we got that, right, and then maybe some data store. So that'd be like the first 4 weeks. And so now you, in 4 weeks, you've got all the tools, even if you don't understand how they work. I mean, half of your, and Caleb said this to me, and this is my own paraphrasing, but he said part of the job of a programmer is being comfortable with working with that which you don't know, right? Like we're always building upon, we're resting on the shoulders of giants. It's like, I can only know so much, and at a certain point, my knowledge stops, and I just have to assume the rest of that stuff works. I know how to interface with it. I know how to connect my stuff with it to make it work, but who the hell really knows how you put together all the cables in the ocean to create, you know, the internet, the network? Who knows, right? I'm great. I don't have to worry about that. It's working. Or TCP, who knows all the intricacies, right? Okay, cool. Like, all right, that's where my knowledge stops. This works, it's serving. So I'd give you like, this works, it's working in the first 4 weeks is kind of what I was thinking. And then we could step back and build, look at like, okay, well now let's actually look at like, how is that actually working and investigate some of those things and reinforce it. So that's what I was thinking about how to teach it this semester. Like, let's see some immediate results, you know? And then if we want, we can, instead of exploring how is that TCP thing working or whatever, we could explore like, oh, let's go into some JavaScript. Oh, let's do some more HTML and CSS. Oh, let's do responsive design. You know, let's do semantics. Let's do whatever. So there's that. I don't know what the question was, but hopefully that answered it for you. All right. Any more questions?
Not a question here, but Todd uses WebStorm a whole bunch. I personally use Atom, which is another. This one's completely free, made by.
Thank you.
Made by GitHub. There's a plugin for Atom called Go Plus, which basically adds all the code completion and error checking and such to it.
Is that me or is that? That's Atom, dude.
Okay, apparently their website's down now.
It's crazy.
But yeah, that's my preference. Atom is a bit lighter weight compared to WebStorm. But one of the reasons I particularly like Atom is Atom's actually written in HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, so I'm actually able to just go into like my style sheet. That's all in CSS. I like, oh, I don't like the color of this. I can open up the CSS file and change the color of my scroll bars if I want. Which was really cool when I was learning web programming to have an editor that was also written in the same tools I was learning about.
Yeah, Atom's great. Highly recommend it. So if you like to switch to Atom, but at City College we teach Android programming, and that uses Android Studio. Android Studio is built on top of IntelliJ. IntelliJ is also a JetBrains product. So we just sort of made the decision we're going to just use JetBrains for our students. They're in web programming, websites. They're using WebStorm. They go into Java programming. They use IntelliJ. They end up in Android programming. They get Android Studio. They already know the environment, right? So it's just sort of a seamless between classes. But Atom would be my second choice if I wasn't using WebStorm. You know, and then you get used to it. And you know where all the buttons are. It's kind of like when you get a new car or something, you're like, how do I turn on the heater? You know? And you're driving, and you're like trying to figure out. It's like, I gotta stop and look.
Atom is pretty heavily based on Sublime Text, which I know quite a few people use as their general all-purpose editor. So most of the keyboard shortcuts to Atom are the same as Sublime Text. So if that entices anyone towards Atom instead.
All right, so we left off here. And we did a little bit of a, you know, we created our own types, person, and then we'd embedded a type. And these are the underlying type, or is that what you'd say? The underlying type is a struct?
Underlying type is a struct.
The underlying type is a struct. And
that struct has a person in it.
That struct has a person in it, so it's embedded in there. And then we created a variable of type 00. And we gave the fields values. And then we did template parse files. Right, because we have a template here. And so that's just HTML. And so to get that into our code and use it, template parse files. And that gives us a temp, you know, two variables back. So I assigned it to that and error, gave us a template and error. So template returns a pointer to a template and error. And we could go look at the documentation. So I could just, if I know what the path is, I could just type in the path, you know, so text templates the path. Or I could just come here and I could search. And there's text template, HTML templates built on top of text template. And then we could look at text template, and the one that we were just looking at is parse files. So parse files. I'm just kind of showing this to help teach the language. And so template parse files gives me a pointer to a template. And then when we have a pointer to a template, all these methods are attached to a pointer to a template. So how many people, when we talk about pointers, they are okay with that? How many people pointers are a little bit like, whoa? Okay. So let me just open up this file, and you'll see this. So, you know, occasionally we'll just, I guess, drop back into learning language. But these are in the videos there, and we have these files on pointers. And so here we have a variable a. It's an int, and the value is 43. And then we print a, and then we could print the address to a, right? And so then we could assign the address to b, and we could print b. So that's what that file is doing. And if we run that, that's kind of small. So we'll understand this in a second here. And Golang training and change directory 08, 01, go run main. So we got 43 and then an address. So we could take the address of a variable. We could see what the address is in memory, right? And when we do that, why would you want to be able to take the address? Why might that be beneficial?
So you can mutate the value without having to replace it later.
Okay, so if we have the location, the memory location, then that allows us to access that location, right? We could also just pass an address if we have a really large data structure. Instead of passing all the data around, we could just pass the address, and the address is much lighter. And then we could always, like, okay, all the data at that point. So we're pointing to that point in memory, a pointer, all right? So let's look at these additional files here. So here, A is 43, then we get the address, so we get this value. And then we could assign that to that, and we print it, and there's that address. And here we are dereferencing. We're dereferencing the address, so we get the value back. So this is a reference. Give me the address. This is a dereference.
All this so far is similar to C++. So main difference, however, in Go, you don't have to worry about explicit memory management. Don't worry about new and delete. Go's garbage collector will get rid of everything for you. So you don't have to worry about deleting everything that you leave behind. Which is really nice.
So here A is 43. Give me the address of that. I'm assigning the address to here. Print the address, dereference it. And then here, I could also say, you know what? At this location in memory, the value there, the dereference, set it equal to 42. And so when I print A, it's now 42. So, right, B is holding the address. I could access the value at that address. I could say the value of that address, now set it equal to this. And now when I print A, which is also, right, what's at that address, it's 42. So no pointer here, x is 5, and then we say, you know what, this function 0, pass in that value, and then we say, you know, z is equal to 0, and then we print it, x is still 5. That's obvious. X is 5. And then we could get the address of x and print the address. And then here, we're just passing in x. X is still 5. So we didn't pass in the address. X is 5. Pass in the address. Now notice that this function, the parameter for it, the argument that it takes, is now a pointer to an int. Right? So this is an int, and we're passing in a pointer now, the address, we're passing in that. So the type is now a pointer to an int. And now we're saying dereference that. So this is part of the type. Pointer to an int is the type. It's just like saying int, but it's a pointer to an int. This is an operator. So that's kind of like plus sign or minus sign. Take a negative, make it a negative. Take an address and give me the value. So we're saying it is 0, and now x is 0. So we've changed it at that point. I guess we're just printing it out once more right here. 5, print the address, pass in the address, takes pointer to an int. This will print out what? What's that going to print out right there?
The address.
The address. This takes the value at that address, makes it 0. And then x is 0. Questions? Anybody explain that a little bit differently to help give clarity to others? Daniel, would you phrase all that in some other way?
Yeah. Where are these files? Are they on your GitHub account?
Mm-hmm.
Or are they?
Yeah, so these files are GitHub. Golang training is the files that correspond with the Udemy Go course. Those are the ones we were just looking at with pointers right there. And then the ones for this class are in Golang Web in HTML CSS. All right, so we use parse files, and we can pass in file names. And we have dot, dot, dot string. So this is a variadic parameter. Variadic meaning varying. A variable amount, a varying number. So I can pass in a varying number of file names, unlimited, from 0 to n, whatever I want. And then this is going to give me a pointer to a template and an error as a return. So when I have a pointer to a template, I now have all of these methods available. So I can start looking through here and seeing what do I want to use. What do these different things do? So there's execute, execute template, right? So we're going to use execute. We're going to do it to standard out. And we're going to pass in P1, pass in our data. So if we go look at execute and parse files, let's look at parse files, look at execute, execute template. Parse files creates a new template, and parses the template definitions from the name files. The return template's name will have the base name and parse contents of the rest of the file, of the first file. The base name and parse contents of the first file. There must be at least one file. If an error occurs, parsing stops, and the return pointer to template is nil. And then execute writer, data, and error, and it returns an error, so it takes a writer and data. Execute template, writer, data, and a name. So if we just want to execute one template out of many, we can say, hey, this one, and then it returns an error. And that's the example we'll see in this next one. So right here we use template execute, standard out, P1. We saw this run last week. Anybody want to see it run again? That'll help you sort of wrap your head around what the code's doing. Yes? So we are in 009. Where's this one? Control-C, change directory. So got this template. We parsed it. Template parse files, this template. And then we said, hey, template execute to standard out, give it this data. Because template execute takes a writer and data.
So the writer interface there basically is anything you can write to. So in this case, we're using OS standard out, which is connects to your console. But you could also put in, I think last time we showed files that can go to a file, dump to a file. But then most often a web server, your writer there will be the connection to the web browser. And so normally you'll make your page, you'll template it, and then you'll execute your template, and your writer will be the connection to the web browser. So then the web browser gets the HTML, and it knows how to draw HTML.
So what this one has execute, but and I put next class because that's what we were going to pick up with in this class. So here's parse files, and now parse files here has execute template, right? So let's look at the difference there, execute versus execute template. So we've got a custom type, underlying type. It's a struct. Custom type is a struct. And then parse files. Now we're parsing two files. Hey, parse both of these because over here I got two files, two templates. All right, parse both of them. That's not too hard, right? And then I could say template execute OS standard out, which file? And I'm passing in a struct literal here, right? So just, and when I don't say things correctly, just correct me. Daniel's got a lot of knowledge. He went through boot camp with me, and I want to make sure that we use the right terms to describe this. And even though I've read a ton and been to trainings and taught this class already, there's times I'm like, am I saying that right? So please just jump in if I ever say it right. So we do a struct literal there. So the literal values inside this struct. We're not assigning it to a variable. Would you call this an anonymous struct literal? Because there's no variable name, right?
No, it would just be
just struct literal. So template execute to standard out, put in the data right there. And so
Can you reference that, put the address sign on it? Sometimes Go doesn't let you.
Right here?
Yeah. So in this case, the template execute can take either a pointer or a non-pointer. In this case, we're passing in two strings, which is actually a pretty decent amount of data. So it's almost worth it to pass in a pointer to the data instead of the data itself. Since the execute works on either one.
Oh, data interface. It could totally take a pointer, right? Yeah. Empty interface. All right, so let's run that. And we'll get the code under it. There we go. Okay. So when I ran that, this was the first one, right? These lines down here are under here, other executes. And so I've said parse both of these files, And then I'm just executing to stander out, and I haven't specified anything. So which file, hello page one, which file, hello page one, which file. So I could go back and I could look at my templates and figure out which one that was. So if I look at this one, title, this is the title from template two, this is the body from template two, and from template one, from just TPL, from TPL. And so that first one is from TPL. From TPL, from TPL. So even though I parsed two files, if I just use execute, it just executes the first one. So if we look at the documentation on that, execute applies a parse template to the specified data object and writes the output to WR. So that's pretty much, you know, what that is, right? If an error occurs executing the template or writing its output, execution stops, but partial results may already have been written to the output writer. A template may be executed safely in parallel.
It's in parse files. I mentioned it was the first one.
And then, oh, is that where it was? Okay. Parse files creates a new template and parses the template definitions from the name files. The return template's name will have the base name and parse contents of the first file.
Parsing in this instance just means looking through or scanning?
So yeah, the template, the parse file is where it actually loads the files and scans and finds where it needs to replace data and such, and puts in an optimum organization so it can actually insert the data really fast when it's actually running it, executing it. Because when you got a web page, yeah, it may take a while to scan through all your different pages, but then you want to be able to put the data in and serve it to the web browser as fast as possible. So parse files loads it and gets it ready for that extremely fast insert data and send it out.
So the documentation sometimes is a little bit like enigmatic. Like the return template's name will have the base name and parse contents of the first file. So here's the return template's name, right? Has the base name and parse contents of the first file. There's the base name. We could, what if we made this just TP? What does that mean? Just out of curiosity.
The name being an internal variable in template, not a
not something we use.
Yeah.
And parse contents of the first file. Interesting. All right, so then we also have template execute template to standard out, and we can specify template go HTML. And we're doing to template, and then down here we're doing TPL2. Right, specifying TPL2, specifying TPL. So when we look at the results of that one, we have specifying TPL, and that's from TPL, so that's the one that got specified. And then we also have specifying TPL2 and from TPL2. So with execute template, when we have multiple templates, so we have multiple templates that got parsed. If we just do execute, it's basically the first one. It gets executed because we didn't specify. But if we do execute template, we specify, and we can specify which template that we parsed. Okay, so that's the big takeaway. Even though we kind of delve into like a little bit of like what is the documentation, let's understand uncertainty. The takeaway is first thing, parse your templates. Second thing, execute your templates. Your choices for executing templates are execute or execute template. And execute will do the first one if you parse more than one. And execute template, you specify which one. Everybody got that? Yeah, that's not too bad. Have I told you guys this quote? The quote is from J.W. Audubon, I think that's his name. Founder Audubon Society. What's his name? John Muir? None of those guys. I don't know who said this quote, but I like it. I was told it was the founder of the Audubon Society, but see, Jay Audubon, so maybe it is something. But he said, when the book and the bird differ, believe the bird, right? And so it's the same way. Like, will it do it? I don't know. Let's run it, and then we'll know. So here's the second time. Okay. That's a good question. So which file from TPL? And second time, TPL. So it's always just the first one. No, it's the first one. This is from TPL. From TPL versus from TPL2, right? So in my templates, I have TPL2, which says this is titled from TPL2. So that's the template where the data got put in. And here from TPL, from just TPL, right? So here's the first, it's from TPL. Here's the second from TPL. And the data is just what passed in. I just put in second time. And then here specifying TPL and specifying TPL2. Did I get rid of that second time one? I've made my text so big on here, it's like, so you guys could see it. It's nice. Execute. I don't need this one. Execute template. Let's just make sure it runs so I didn't break it. Cool.
You said there was like a parameter for specifying like the second template that you passed in execute watch files or whatever.
So for the second one.
Execute's always the first one. Always the first one.
Yeah, and then execute template you could specify right here. Okay. All right. So, well, that's kind of awkward. You can imagine your site has like a whole bunch of pages. This is going to be a long list. 30 pages, 30 templates, right? That's a lot. So there's parse glob. And parse glob will just parse an entire directory. And so in the templates directory, I have a bunch of GoHTML. In the old days of web programming, you'd have PHP files or ASP files or CFM files. It's kind of file-based, right, and direct in that sense. Go is just programmatic. You could call this whatever you want. You could call it my dumb aunt in Oregon. dot espresso, whatever you want. It doesn't matter. So here, GoHTML is a common extension, but it doesn't matter. You could give whatever extension you want.
Just if you want to use parseglob, though, make sure you use the same extension so you can find them all.
Yeah. So here, in parseglob, I say any file name that ends with this. Inside this folder. So inside this folder, I got these two. And then the rest of this is just template execute. It's going to do that first template. Execute template. It's going to do that one. Execute template. It'll do this one. So that's the same as before. The parse glob is the new piece of information you're learning here.
So one thing to note, though, if you're using parse glob, you probably don't want to use execute because who knows what order that it will actually find your files. So you don't actually know which one came first. So in this case, it's probably TPL, just plain TPL.
That's interesting.
It most likely finds it in alphabetical order, but it's not actually like guaranteed in any way. So you probably want to use execute template.
Yeah, so the first one it found was TPL. Yeah, but if it's in alphabetical order, that'd be funny. Let's do that and make this a temple 2. And now run it, see what happens. Yeah, it came from that one.
Yeah, it looks like it's so yeah, but then that may be OS dependent too. It has to ask the OS what files are in the that directory. So overall, if you're using parseglob, probably want to use the execute template and specify what file that you want the template to run from.
All right, so we were talking about the text templating. And we have seen some HTML templates, but I just want also to demonstrate the. Anybody have any questions about the parsing and executing? That's not too hard, right? That's like a good takeaway. One class, I got that piece. I know how to do that. So there's a difference between text template and HTML template, and I just want to show that. And so here we have main.go, and we're using text template. And so I have a struct and with those fields in it. And then I'm creating a variable home of type page, which is a struct, giving it data, giving those fields values. And title, nothing has escaped. And input, like a user maybe gave me this input, right? And I'm parsing files. I'm going to parse my template. So here's my template. I'm passing in the title, the heading, and the input. So I will pass in, when I execute this template, home, right? Like this is my home page. Here's the data for my home page. And then all of those fields will be available in my template through dot notation, dot title, dot heading, dot input. And so then those will show, including this right here. So when we run this, just looking, checking something out.
You're going to OS standard out, so you probably are using the greater than symbol to dump the HTML file.
Yeah, yeah. So, change 012. Thank you, though. So it writes it out there, and you can see it comes out just like that. And, I could do go run build.
No, just
how you want to do it?
Go build. Just
go build.
Yeah, go build.
Go build, thank you. And if I build it, it'll give me an executable. And it'll put it in that same directory.
That's how you get your .exe on Windows.
That's how you get your .exe. I could also do go install. And it'll then put it into my bin folder in my workspace under source. But to run that one right there, go build. And let me get rid of this file right there.
You don't run go build anymore, you just run the
executable. Sorry, 012.
It no longer has anything to do with Go. You can give that to someone who doesn't has never heard of Go.
There we go. So it'll run this and then put the output into index.html.
So greater than symbols of Linux and Mac only. Windows users can't do that, as far as I'm aware.
Some way of doing it, I can't remember.
There might be, but it's different. It's not that.
You need to install other terminal in Windows to use that operator.
Yeah, you can install Bash. Yeah, you can install Bash on Windows to get that,
right.
But it's not built in.
So this is an example of pipelining. The output of this becomes the input of that. Put it into there. And so when I look at this file now, I got that file and nothing's escaped. So when I run it, somebody put input, could have put input into a form, and I use that data, and I build a template and put that data on a page, and then that page executes, and they've just executed JavaScript. And that's cross-site scripting. So somebody was able to put code into my site through a submission box. And then that code gets put into a page and runs.
They might redirect you to some virus site or whatever. So not what you want.
So that's just to illustrate cross-site scripting, and nothing has escaped. And so here we're going to use HTML template instead. And this is going to be, everything will be escaped, danger is escaped. So we try to put that in, parse our file, takes a title, heading, and input, right? That's the data that gets passed in when we execute it. So we execute and pass in the data. And then again, that one's just going to do, so I'll get rid of this one. Like that. So now you can see all this has escaped. So that's no longer going to be dangerous. So if I did go build, and then
you can do that greater than symbol from go run too, by the way.
Oh yeah. So it even looks like it, because the browser will interpret those characters. The browser will interpret these characters and then display what that is. But in the code, right, they are escaped when they come over. So they don't run. And what else is there to say about that? The
so like in the template, we had some little extra code saying that the
So the only difference is we imported HTML/template instead of
text. That's the only difference, yeah.
Exact same functions, exact same way it works. Only difference is we import from a different package, and that package, when it's executing, it's escape text.
Yeah, so if we ran this one, text template, it's not escaped. But if we make this HTML, okay. And you can read about all the escaping it does. So
and
it's
disable it temporarily.
Yeah, go doc. Net H. No, that's not it. Template. HTML template. And escape. Escape. Output. Escaping. Some examples of different escaping which will occur. And the escaping is context sensitive. So in different places where you might use data, it'll escape it differently.
So like in CSS, it'll use CSS escaping, and HTML it'll use HTML escaping. If you're in the middle of a style tag on HTML, it'll use CSS escaping. So get smart about that.
So escaping is, what is escaping?
So it's replacing the symbols. Like in HTML, every tag is surrounded with the less than and greater than symbols. So one of the common escapes for HTML is just to replace the less than symbol with the ampersand LT semicolon, which web browsers will know means show a less than symbol, don't act as if it's a less than symbol for the purposes of executing the page. Similar to how in most programming languages you can use / n for new line, because if you just put a direct new line in there, it usually means the end of the line. This probably, for like Python, that's the end of the statement. But if you just do /n, it knows when it's printing, put a new line in.
Yellow actually showed up better. I really like this Chrome plugin I found about highlighting pages. You could highlight web pages and it remembers it. Anybody in here a highlighter? I'm a big highlighter. It's like the old school thing where the old dudes. So here's a whole, these are called HTML entities, right? And so here are the different entities. Less than, greater than. You could use and less than or and pound 60. So and less than or and pound 60. And less than's right there. And greater than, so it escaped those characters so that this would no longer be interpreted as a tag. You know, an opening bracket and closing on each side, greater than, less than.
So never trust your users. If you got any information from a user, make sure you're using HTML template before you give it to anyone else.
All right, so that's the end of templates. Cross-site scripting, text template, HTML template, parse files, parse glob, execute, what was the other one? Execute template. And so the next thing is to take a look at how do we start serving pages. So here we have HTTP handle func. We give it a route. And we say which function we want to execute.
Go show the import. Oh, they can see it on the top. So yeah, HTTP handle func comes from net/HTTP in the imports. That's also where you find it in the Go doc.
And then we do listen and serve, and we give it the port. And we pass in nil here. So listen and serve, if we go look at net/HTTP, we kind of look at some of that documentation. Listen and serve starts an HTTP server with a given address and handler. The handler is usually nil, which means to use default serve mux. Handle and handle func add handlers to default serve mux. Handle and handle func add handlers to default serve mux. So nil means we're using default serve mux. We could change this and pass in something else, which there are examples where we might do that. We have listen and serve and listen and serve TLS. So this would be for doing like HTTPS.
If you've got any passwords, you want to use HTTPS. If they're giving you a password, you want to make sure that's encrypted before it goes over the internet. So HTTP TLS will give you the HTTPS, which is encrypted instead. But it requires some security certificates, which require going through some extra steps, getting them set up. The certain and other stuff. So, which sometimes costs money, sometimes not, depending on where you get them from and how dodgy a website you want to trust.
It's free in Israel.
Yeah.
It's free in Israel. So listen and serve listens on the TCP network address at ADDR and then calls serve with handler to handle requests on incoming connections. Handler is typically nil, in which case default serve mux is used. So, I just show the documentation so that you could start to become familiar with how the documentation works and begin familiarizing ourselves with it and then seeing how the code works. Eventually, maybe the documentation will start to make some sense because the documentation is a little bit hard to comprehend. So, let's watch this run and then we'll come back and walk through it. I am in 14. Foo-ran. And I come back here and I do a /dog. Bar-ran.
Do you have dog set to, yeah, so you can put anything after dog.
Yeah, I could add anything after this. Bar will run. If I did not have the slash here, the slash means handle anything that comes in at this path, right, and anything after it. If I didn't have that slash, only handle things that come in at /dog. So if I change that and then come back here and control C will kill your server, and then go run it again. And now if I try to refresh that page, it goes to foo. Why did this now go to foo? Because it matches the best match, the most specific match. Well, before we had it like that, it would catch anything after dog. It would catch dog and anything after it. Here, it's only going to catch dog. And so the closest match is this, which catches everything. Forward slashes everything. So if I go back to dog, now it's foo.
Still foo. Because you got the lead, you got the back. You still have a slash there.
Just give me dog, that one. Why isn't it doing that?
You must have a permanent redirect from another web page or something.
Bar. That's web programming.
Yeah. there was probably a redirect 301, permanent redirect sent to you one time.
So a handle func needs a handler func. For something to be a handler func, it needs to have these, the signature.
So, yeah, okay. Handler func comes is a type. If you want to look that up.
Yeah.
It's a good one to show.
So when I read documentation, often I just search for what I'm looking for. And so handle func. And look in the index, right? What are the links? There's a link there for handle func, serve mux, and then handle func up here. We'll look at this one first. So handle func, and just look at how it's used. Handle func, that, and this. Handle func registers the handler function for the given pattern in the default serve mux. So registers the handler function for the given pattern, in the default serve mux. So it's registering it in the default serve mux. Mux stands for multiplexer. And a multiplexer is, anybody know what that is from engineering?
CSI 113.
So multiplexer kind of chooses, makes choices. And so it's registering with the default serve mux, default serve multiplexer, the handler function for the given pattern. For this pattern, use this handler func. The documentation for serve mux explains how patterns are matched. So this handler func has this signature. It has to have a response and a request, because the way the web works is basically people make requests and then servers respond.
Note that Go lets you pass entire functions around as first order values. So that particular function takes another function as an argument. You can't do that in like C without a lot of complicated stuff with function pointers. But Go just lets you take it just fine.
So all that diagram shows right there is like somebody on a web browser making a request to a server, and then the server responds. There's a request line and a response line, also known as a status line, which has a little information about the request or the response. And then there'll be some headers in each of them, some header information. And there can be a body in each of them. So it's called content in the response right there. But in the request, you could also have a body if somebody's submitting a form. But if we look at just the basic action, yeah. So right now we're just serving on our own computers, just developing.
Just run this app on my Mac or whatever.
Yeah.
To get a specific URL, you would have to purchase that from a domain name register, and we'll get to that too, because you probably don't want to run it off of your laptop or something. So, but yeah, if you just want it locally, then yeah, localhost basically means my own computer.
Yeah.
So you can type that into any web browser, and it'll mean go to server on my own computer.
So in that colon.
That's in general. If you type localhost in every web browser, it means my own computer. And that web, and then that Go program is creating a HTTP server. Any web, and all web browsers know how to use a HTTP server. So you could write this in Python if you wanted to do the same thing.
Did that answer your question? You're wanting to know, like, how do I actually serve this at a domain, right?
Yeah, or how does it work when I do it locally? Let's say if I have another listener and serve, say, another port, right? Does it know, or is it registered here, right there?
This colon 8080 is what's saying what port it is it's using, and when he's going to it on his web browser, he's using localhost colon 8080 in the URL bar. So if you had two servers, you would use different ports for each of them. The reason he's not using the default port, which is what, 22,
I think.
80? Default for serving web pages is 80. Yeah.
22,000 H. So yeah, port 80 is the default for web browsers, but that's usually locked to admin only on most computers because it's such an important port. Since we don't want to run Go in admin mode while we're just experimenting and fiddling with it, we're just using an alternate port instead. But if you wanted to run it off somewhere, you would run it on port 80, so they wouldn't have to specify the port. And then, so we will be using App Engine later on.
Yeah.
They'll deal with all those hard details for you.
And we'll also show you how to do it on just a Linux machine on DigitalOcean. So if you want to set up a machine somewhere else and do it that way. All right. So that's why up here the handler func has both the request and the response. So we could access, you know, information from the request and the response. And we can use the response to respond. We're using write string here.
You can use fprint as well.
Use fprint, because response implements the writer interface. And write string asks for a writer. And the way response is implementing the writer interface, if we looked at HTTP response writer,
I think those are all clickable links, so.
Yeah, so I could just do the...
Just grab any one of them that's got it as a parameter and click on it.
There we go. So this right here has that... So this is an interface, and it has this right there, that method. So if it has these methods, anything that has these three methods will implement the response writer interface. So that's what a response writer is. And if we look at the write interface... Yeah. How is it that sometimes that works and it doesn't?
There it is. Bottom.
Typewriter, did you see it?
There it is.
There we go. So typewriter is an interface. So anything with this method right here implements the writer interface. So since this has that method, slice of bytes and error, slice of bytes and error, then response writer is implementing the writer interface. And what did we use there? Write string, IO write string, says I want a writer, right? I want a writer. And response is a writer. So write string will then write this to the writer, which writes our response back.
Note that unlike Java, you don't have to explicitly say, I'm implementing this interface. If you've got the functions, you're implementing it. So response writer didn't have to explicitly say, I'm implementing writer. It just said, I've got this write method. And all writers say, hey, if you got that method, you're a writer.
All right, so this first one, let's look at a couple more. So this first one here, we just basically, we're saying, you know, at this route, run this function. At this route, or anything after it, run this function. So we ran those two functions, and we just wrote back some text. In the next one, right, can we use that server with templates? So we have a template, dog, this is from dog. And we have main, and main is... here we have handle func foo and dog bar. Well, let's look at them. Foo just runs foo ran. But now bar is template parse files, template execute, and execute asks for writer. And we're passing in no data. So it's going to execute the template back to the response. So control C kills my server. And I'm running my server. So that template came up. And then the regular one, foo, without formatting.
So note that this is not the best way to do your parsing files, because the parse files is the big expensive function that loads them and gets them ready to run. You probably want to run that once at the beginning of the program.
Yeah.
Not like every time they try to connect.
Yeah, so we could have also done template. Is that right?
Yep, it's a pointer to one then.
Oh. So that's
not there.
Make that the address?
Yep. No.
Pointer to a template.
Yep.
And then we could have done this.
Or one too many angle brackets at the end there? Or no,
right. You do need the colon.
Complaining about.
Unused variable. Seems like I'm using it.
It's creating it there. Not going to the global variable. So yeah, you do need to avoid that colon. So yeah, make
oh, I need to error.
Just explicitly declare the error.
There we go. So I could have also done that. And so init is a function to initialize, and it's a special keyword or whatever. And just like you know, you got main init is a function. If you use that name, it runs at the setup of your program and only runs once, so it initializes stuff. So this would only parse my file once. So no matter how many times people came back and visited bar, right, it's just going to execute bar each time. It's not going to each time parse that file over and over and over. We only need to parse that once, right? And then while the server's running, it's already parsed and it's in memory.
Much faster when you got several thousand people trying to visit your website at once, if they can, because otherwise they're all fighting to reload that file separately and gets a big traffic jam.
Very so that slow. Worked too.
So if you look in the docs for Xcute, it'll actually say that Xcute is allowed to be run in parallel, which means it's multi-thread safe. So if you want to use, if you're using multi-threading, which listen and serve actually does internally, you will. It's still you could still use Xcute without any extra special requirements.
So the takeaway from this is to serve files. You're going to do listen and serve, port, nil means default serve mux, and then you'll do handle func, give it a route, then say which function should run, and then okay, here are these functions, and I could just use write string takes a writer and a string, right? You could also maybe play around with that and go look in the documentation, like godoc.org.
Fumped packages got fprint.
Yeah, fprint from fumped. Right, takes a writer and then some data. So I could just use fprint if I wanted, because that would work. But here, this takes a writer and a string. So empty interface is like any data you want, you could put in. So I write string response foo ran, that's what that does. And then here we're doing a template, parsing it and executing it. And then you saw the other way to set it up, which I'm backing out because that's like just another level of thinking.
A bit more complex.
A little bit more complex. So that's serving templates. And then how would we serve a file? Because if if I put together a page, write string, parse files, and here's how you serve a file. Let me just explain it this way. So if you go to /, you get foo. Foo is write string response, foo ran. If you go to /dog, you get bar. Bar is parse TPL that, and then TPL execute response nil. Let's look at TPL. And TPL, this is from dog, right? And then here, if you go to Toby, you get, how do you say that? Who speaks French? Chien. There you go. Because I looked up what is dog in French. And then that will serve, you know, and for serve file, you pass in the response, the request, and then that dog. And once the request, because the request comes over, it has header information, which will tell the computer, you know, who am I sending this back to? And is there some sort of special encoding like gzip or something which I could use to send this more quickly? That's why I speculate it once the request. What would be your thought on that?
It also was for if you got half the image in already downloaded. Like if you go to a web page and it's like loading the images and you leave the page and you come back, it already has those half the images. When it sends the request, it's actually able to stick a header in there saying, I already have up to this much the image. Can you just send me from that point on? And serve files will deal with that for you so you don't have to worry about it.
You can see why I put him on payroll. It's like many minds to attack this problem. So let's take a look at that run, and then we'll experiment with it. So that is 16. And we'll just go to Sheehan, because the rest of this will be the same.
It's a different path. No, you got a different route. So the function is Sheehan.
Oh, it's Toby, right?
Yeah, it's like Toby.
I wanted to show that those were... There we go. I'm going to make that Toby forward slash. There we go. Or not. Help you understand the difference between them. So this is interesting. What would happen if I did... What is it? Toby.
Yeah,
Toby. Just Toby, right?
Yep.
It's kind of weird. No, oh, I do want... Would this work?
No.
It's just Toby, source Toby.
Yeah.
All right, let's see what happens. So...
Reload.
Dog. Yeah, thanks.
No, you don't, because you're parsing the template in the function, so it's happening every time you connect. So that's the one reason why you have the parsing in the function itself instead of being happening once, is when you're doing lots of rapid refiguring and such, because then it happens every time you reconnect, and you have to restart your server every time. When it's an init, it happens at the beginning of the server. When it's in the function, it's happening every time you connect. So it can see updates to the HTML fast, immediately.
Toby.jpg. It's actually dog.jpg. So you can see that's kind of weird. I'm saying serve this file by going there. And so for the image, I'm just putting in go to that location. Right? It makes sense, but it's like, oh, that's not the way...
Yeah, what's visible from the internet has got a complete disconnect from how it is on the file system.
Make sure that's all the way I found it. All right, so that's serving one file. There's also file server for serving many files. So I put a bunch of dogs in here. We saw this right at the beginning of class. Three dogs. And file server is a little bit of an interesting one. But here's main, so routes, handle functs with routes and what to run. And then HTTP handle and resources, strip prefixes, strip prefix resources, file server, HTTP dir forward slash assets. What the heck? So let's look at what's going on here.
You don't need the dots forward slash. You could just put your assets there.
Just like that?
Yep. Well, skip the slash.
Really?
Yep, just put assets.
So here we're saying we're going to do file server at this directory, assets, right there. And I guess you're right. That makes sense. And then we're going to strip the prefix resources. Well, this is a handle, okay? And so you can use handle func or handle. A handle func takes a handler func. Handle func takes a handler func. So handle func, I'm giving it a function with this signature. That's a handler func. A handle takes a handler. And I forget what a handler is.
It's an interface.
It's an interface. Type handler. So handler, interface, serve HTTP, response writer, and request. Yeah, it takes a handler. And this is so when we go to this route, then this is all a handler right here. And if you step through all this, you'll be able to see how they implement the handler interface.
So the reason to use handle instead of handle func is because with handle, you're able to stick additional information in. It just has to have that serve HTTP function method, but then you can have other information in your type that you want to add in. So like in this case, it's got where the data it's trying to get is stored along with its serve HTTP, which just calls serve files.
So handler is kind of like, gives you a little bit more detail on...
Yeah, you can stick additional information. So like if you didn't want to have your template be global, like earlier when we changed it to parsing the files once, we just had a global variable TPL. If we didn't want to have a global file, we could use we could create a type that we could stick the template into and use handle instead, and that way we'd have access to that data.
So just to see, anybody want to see how this is a handler that's interesting to you, or you're not interested? It's interesting to you, raise your hand. Okay. So the first thing I would do is I'd look at HTTP dir. So let's look here first and see if it tells us anything. Actually, we got to look at the documentation. So add HTTP, find dir, type dir. Dir is a string, implements file system using native file system, directory tree. All right, so we have a string here. Dir is a string, HTTP dir, and then if you have a dir, you've got open, and what else?
File server is the next one up.
HTTP dir, func dir, open, and then we have file server. Handler file server. And file server root takes a file system, right? A root is a word identifier, file system, and it gives us a handler. Oh, cool, we got a handler. So file server gave us a handler. So there's our handler. And so this needed to be a handler, and file server just gave us one. So file server gives us the handler, and then we do a strip prefix, and we're stripping the prefix off of resources.
Strip prefix takes in a prefix and a handler, and basically any path that comes in that's got that prefix at the beginning, it cuts that off before passing the rest of the path along to the underlying handler. So what this means is we've got a folder assets there. We don't know about resources on the file system, we just have the assets. File server takes in a dir, says assets. Okay, so it says, okay, we got this folder assets. We can give you any file that's inside this folder assets. Cool. We try to request something from this file. We say resource/resources/dog.jpg. There's no resources folder inside assets. So strip prefixes will remove that resource. Now you just see dog.jpg. File server says, in assets, we got this dog.jpg. We can serve you this just fine. That's what the strip prefix is there for.
Instead of having, what I think I'm hearing is that instead of having resources twice, you only have it once.
So, or rather, the resources file server is searching in assets. So we need to make sure our path comes from a base of inside the assets folder.
Okay.
So if we we go slash, so if we pass in something that says, if we pass in a path that says resources/dog, we'll look in assets folder and say, okay, we need a resources/dog. There's no resources folder inside assets, and so it'll give us a 404 error. And file not found.
So notice how I access.
So then you said was, this is the prefix that I want you to remove.
Get rid of it. And now you just, so it gets rid of it and then passes it to file server, and file server says, oh, dog.jpg starting in assets, we've got that.
Okay.
So it's a bit of a complicated line, but it just basically says anything in this folder, you can get to it. So you would have a separate handle func for every separate path, but like the assets folder, you can just have that one line and then just have a bunch of stuff in your assets folder.
Isn't there some kind of like, I don't know, XML config file or something that I can put in, dumping all those URLs with their functions instead of listing them all down like that?
Like this, yeah.
Yeah.
Somewhat, but then it can give you a lot of power too. As we get later on into some of the Ajax stuff, you can see, you'll see why they gave this much configurability. So most of the time, though, yeah, you can just copy paste from a previous project.
This is not trivial.
No,
it's not trivial. And when they ask professional developers what's easier, web programming or app programming, hands down, without a doubt, what the vast majority of people say is app programming. iOS, Android, clear pathway, there's a library we work with, that's it. The web is woolly and wild and unwieldy, and you know, there's all kinds of different technologies you could use, and there's all kinds of different ways you can do it, and you could go with something that, you know, abstracts everything away for you, or you could get something that gives you more control. You know,
like right here, for example,
and he's not using handle func
here.
Yeah,
he's using a mix here, handle and some other thing. See, there's a million ways to do things right.
There's a million ways to do it, and so this is a router that somebody else wrote, third party package, which is pretty popular and more performant, very very performant, and it gives you some functionality like variable names, right? So here I've got :user, so this could be any username. Right, and so you could do things like that, but you do have to be specific. You put together your application, and say what happens when somebody goes to this path. What happens when they go to that path? I mean, it's a distributed application that is open to anybody all the time, and they are connecting to your servers, your databases. You know, so you. I mean, it's a lot. It's a lot to get your head around. I don't underestimate it. It's not trivial, but it's also engaging, right? Because it's like, it's a really big puzzle, and it isn't about like, can I understand all of it? It's like, can I understand enough of it? What I need to know to get my thing to work, right? Like, you know, don't try to be a Node.js. Don't try to be a Python. Don't try to be a Ruby. Don't try to be a PHP and a Go developer. Choose one. And then do that. Which one are you going to choose, right? And so we are giving you a lot the first week. Maybe this isn't the best approach. I can kind of sense that people are a little bit like, whoa, a little bit hard to talk to. But at the same time, even if, and that's what I started out the class with, even if you don't understand all of this, you've got it. Who cares, right? Like, build something. Get it running on your computer. Just come in here and copy code and change images. And you know, I basically gave you all the little pieces. Now you just put them together. I mean, it's basically to build this one page right here, which is, what the heck, way down here, the challenge where we started. You're going to build this page, but then you're going to have to, I don't want you to serve it just out of WebStorm like I just did, where WebStorm did the serving. I want you to do it with Go. So you have to take the Go code and turn this text here into a template and then parse that template and execute that template, right? And then serve that and give it the port and nil, default serve mux, And then also make sure that that image is serving, and you're done. So even if you just took this code and were able to get this to run with Go, like that's a really good exercise. And understanding it completely, you will never understand it completely. You know, there's holes in my, vast holes in my knowledge. You know, I know what I know, other people know what they know, but all together we start figuring it out and we can make something. But it is, in some ways, for me at least, it's almost like meditation or something, you know, like when I'm at home and everybody's asleep and it's late at night and I feel like the moth in front of the flame or something, just me and my laptop, and it's like, why is that working? How did I get it to do something different? So you got the pathway here, and we're serving files. And the thing that we were just talking about is like, this is at this location, resources, but it's pulling it out of the assets folder. And the way we're serving all those files is file server from this folder. But then since we're asking for resources, so whenever something comes in this, okay, I'm going to run this handler, right? Because this is the path. But I'm going to first strip off resources because we don't have a resources. That will leave me with like dog. That if I take off this from here, I took that off. So I am left with /dog2.jpg. Where is that coming from? Assets. And the reason that I didn't, you know, name this assets and this assets is because then you would be like, what the hell? Right? If this was all assets, you'd be like, handle assets, strip assets, HTTP dir assets, that's nuts. Which is the way I saw it when I first saw it. I'm like, what the hell is that doing? That just looks like craziness. But I realize if I change it like this, okay, we're saying this resource, you know, and I'm stripping that, and it's just leaving me with this, and it's saying serve it from there. Okay, cool, got it. And where's that? That's just this folder right here. Questions? That's it. That's what I have for you today. And your homework for the weekend is to take 18 challenge. And we'll just call this the surfer page. And dang, I closed the syllabus.
Oh, and one reason to use the HTTP serve files there is that it doesn't allow them to use the dot dot to get back up folders and eventually get to like your Windows folder or your boot folder or something.
You mean file server?
Yeah, file server.
Okay.
So yeah, the HTTP dir there says assets. You can't go anywhere outside of assets, so they can't if. With some servers, you can actually use dot dot slash dot dot and eventually get your way back up to like their root folder and start messing around trying to have them serve like their passwords file where it stores their passwords. That's not a good thing.
I just saw on the news yesterday on Y Combinator. If you don't follow Y Combinator, it's like hacker news. It's also known as hacker news. And it isn't just about hacking. It's just like this is created by, I think, a venture capital fund in San Jose, some people who are involved with the venture capital fund. But I just read something on here the other day about Ruby on Rails and like these vast security holes inside Ruby on Rails that they've just discovered, you know. But Go is very solidly built by people with really great credentials. And so, you know, it suffers no fools. It's genius level. Literally, the people who made it are geniuses in computer science. And so the language they speak when they write the documentation, the way they say it, and everything, that could be hard for us normal people to assimilate, right? But I also have a lot of confidence and faith that they put it together right. Like, just even for the reason Daniel mentioned, it's like this right here is only serving from that directory. So when we use this, that security hole that other potential server-side languages have, where you could, you know, navigate up. You can't do that here, you know. And the fact that HTML template does all that cross-site scripting escaping, you know. So even if I don't understand all of it, I have confidence in the people who built it. And what I do learn about it, it's like, oh, good, they took care of that. Versus other languages, I learn about other languages, and sometimes I'm like, it's kind of a red flag, like I was telling you about Python, right? Backwards compatibility. Any other questions? So you guys know your homework? How do you feel? Talk to me. I know it's kind of like a quiet session. We're muddling through some hard stuff, trying to find the right way to convey it to you because you don't have a lot of the foundation. But let's just try it this way and see how it goes, where it's like, heck, you barely know the language, but you've got the pieces. See if you can get it to work. And if in a couple of weeks it's not making sense, we could step back and focus more on the language and then come back to the web. But hopefully it'll all start to click. Hopefully you're doing the training with the language too. All right?
They do have a lab, right?
Yeah, it's supposed to be right now.
So,
it's supposed to be 12 to 1, but
okay, so
fast lecture and then 1 to 2 is
one to two,
lab.
Right. One to two.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm supposed to come here only, right?
You're welcome anytime.
Yeah.
So if you got other stuff you need to do, that's fine. It means
I think
you know this stuff well enough that you can help people.
Yeah.
But it might also be good for you to hear it again, just to
hear it again. And if you're going
to
Denver, it will be a refreshing knowledge again, for sure.
And you can contribute if you have things to say.
Yeah, I have one thing like with GitHub pages where they can make put the file and make a website for it. I was still